I walked down and looked at that. Went to the bathroom. I had to yell and it's a transformation from 6 to 9. They're having a reception there afterwards. You know, they didn't care if we had stuff in the wall. But it looks
good
beautiful.
Thing.
Yeah.
I just got to go over and say hello.
Okay, do you want your cane?
Nope.
Oh, okay.
You know, I bought this book about Christmas and gave it to Annie Stanley, and it tells you more than you would ever want to know about Christmas all over the world. Mm-hmm. And it said that people in Caracas, Venezuela ride roller skate to church on Christmas Eve. And I thought, how would that have ever got started? Why did they do that? And in this book, asks more, you know, it leads to more questions than answers.
Oh my goodness. Now you have to Google it.
Figure out why anybody would roller skate to church on Christmas Eve.
Yeah, how did that ever get started? Yeah. You're right. Oh my goodness.
So when I saw roller skates, I
would be happy right now.
My mother and father met a brother in Morris, Illinois.
Oh.
And they were big skaters. And, my mom had the dream, of course, like I think a lot of young women had at the time. She got married.
Yes.
But, I remember, you know, watching the roller derby with my grandma. Oh my gosh, she loved it. But, it's made a comeback. There's teams around. But I was never really good at four wheels. You know, not one leg, forget it. Give me one more way. I skipped.
Looks like maybe that might have been a lot for all the stuff that's going on today. So, should probably just.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Welcome as we gather on this Sunday. This Sunday we are celebrating World Communion Sunday, and we also have a baptism, so it is a great day to be together to worship God. As we listen to our prelude, I invite you to center yourselves and prepare yourselves for worship.
Good morning. Welcome to First Church of Lombard, United Church of Christ. Welcome however you are joining us for worship today, here in the sanctuary or online. First Church of Lombard is committed toward modeling a community of faith and spirit that works toward unity, openness, and understanding, and peace by offering love, justice, healing, and wholeness for all people as an open and affirming and a just peace congregation. Children in preschool through fifth grade begin worship with their families and will be dismissed to Sunday school shortly. For parents who need a quiet, calm place to go with smaller children, the nursery is available across from the main office. The audio of the service as well as activities for infants and toddlers are accessible, but the room is not staffed. Please fill out the ministry pad in the red plastic folders and pass it along to others in your pew. There's one in each pew. If you're visiting, we'd appreciate it if you leave us your name, address, email, or phone number so we can contact you this week and let you know how happy we are that you've worshiped with us today. The crop walk is today. Plan to enjoy a walk along the prairie path and the Great Western Trail with First Church and community friends while supporting our local food programs and needs around the world. This event is family friendly and there will be a bounce house, games, and raffles. It will start and end at First Church. We hope you'll be able to join us and our team of Agape Walkers. Everyone is invited to Community Table this Wednesday, October 9th at 5:30 in the Fellowship Hall to enjoy a great meal in great company. If you'd like to hear about upcoming events and receive the news and notes via email, please contact Bea Castillo in the church office to be added to the email list. A limited number of hard copies of this week's news and notes are available in the narthex. Can I have Linda come up for her announcement, please?
As most of you know, we had our rummage sale this past weekend, and I just wanted to give you a quick overview of what happened. So whether you helped plan the rummage sale, whether you helped set up, whether you donated, whether you helped work it or clean up, which was a huge help, you all helped us raise over $3,000 for the rummage for the church. And then the numbers aren't even in yet because I still owe $25. There's more money coming in. The jewelry hasn't even been counted yet. So I expect the numbers to even rise more. That money will go towards outreach for the community to help build, repair things in the church, to go to retreats and mission trips and everything. So thank you, thank you, thank you. I appreciate it all.
Thank you all for your work on the rummage sale. What a great outcome. Please stand and greet each other for the passing of the peace. Thank you. Please join me in the opening prayer. Almighty God, even as the drums of warfare beat on throughout the night, even as the cries of injustice linger in the morning, even as the hustle of busyness rumbles through the day, quiet our hearts, still our thoughts, join us in worship. Remember us in your mercy as we try to remember you through the proclamation of your good news in story and in song, and through the hospitality of your gracious table. Welcome us again, one Lord, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated.
At this time, I'd like to invite the family and sponsors of Bennett Schmucker to come forward for his baptism. Today we celebrate the baptism of Bennett Warren Schmucker. Bennett is the child of Kyle Schmucker and Sarah Kramer, and he's the little brother of Christopher. And his sponsors are Trevor Taylor and Kayla Grody. Bennett is a great nephew of Vicki and Al Webb, and also the great grandson of the late Jane and Ted Seaman, and has a lot of connections here at First Church, and that is why he's being baptized here today. We remember that they were bringing children to Jesus that Jesus might touch them. And the disciples rebuked them, but Jesus saw it and said, "Let the little children come to me, do not hinder them, for to such belongs the realm of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the realm of God like a child shall not enter it." And Jesus took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. Elsewhere in the Bible, Jesus came to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to make him change his mind. "I ought to be baptized by you," John said, "yet you have come to me." Jesus said, "Let it be so for now, for in this way we shall do all that God requires." So John agreed. As soon as Jesus was baptized and came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and the Spirit of God came down like a dove and lit upon him. Then a voice from heaven said, "This is my own dear Son, whom I am well pleased." And at another time, Jesus said to his disciples, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." So we in the church celebrate the sacrament of baptism as an outward and visible sign of the grace of God. Inasmuch as it is possible, the gospel is not only for us, but it is also for our children. Baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the mark of their acceptance into the care of Christ's church. It is the sign and seal of their participation in God's forgiveness, and it is the beginning of their growth into full Christian faith and discipleship. So first, I want to ask you, Kyle and Sarah, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, say, "We do." And now I want to ask you and the sponsors, do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciple, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able? If so, say, "We do," with the help of God. And do you promise, according to the grace given to you, to grow with this child in the Christian faith, to help him to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, by celebrating Christ's presence, by furthering Christ's mission in all the world, and by offering the nurture of the Christian church so that one day he may affirm his baptism? If so, say, "We do," with the help of God. Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism and to offer support through the entire church family. So I want to ask those gathered here, the members and friends of First Church of Lombard, do you promise your love, support, and care of the one about to be baptized as he lives and grows in Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Let us pray. We thank you, God, for the gift of creation called forth by your saving word. Before the world had shape or form, your spirit moved over the waters. Out of the waters of the deep, you formed the firmament and brought forth the earth to sustain all life. In the time of Noah, you washed the earth with the waters of the flood, and your ark of salvation bore a new beginning. In the time of Moses, your people, Israel, passed through the Red Sea from slavery into freedom and crossed the flowing Jordan to enter the promised land. In the fullness of time, you sent your son, Jesus, who was nurtured in the water of the womb. Jesus was baptized by John in the water of the Jordan and became living water to a woman at the Samaritan well. He washed the disciples' feet and sent them forth to baptize all nations by water and the Holy Spirit. Bless, O Lord, by your Holy Spirit this water. Create new life in the one about to be baptized this day, that he may rise in Christ. Glory to you, eternal God, the one who was and is and shall always be, world without end. Amen. By what name is this child to be called? Right. Bennett? Hi, Bennett. Hey. Bennett, Warren, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You are marked and sealed as Christ's own forever. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have filled the world with joy by giving us the gift of Jesus. Bless this newly baptized child. May he be filled with joy. May he never be ashamed to confess a personal faith in you. And may you bless the sponsors and parents of this child. May they always show their gratitude for the life you have given. May they always love and care for Bennett. And God bless these, your faithful people gathered here today. Unite them in the peace of Christ and in the company of the Holy Spirit. We celebrate the gift of Bennett and are grateful for the gift that he is and will be. Praise be to God. Amen. Let's welcome Bennett with a quiet round of applause so you don't scare him. Look at, that's your church family, Bennett. I'm going to sing, well, we are all going to sing Jesus Loves Me as I walk around with Bennett and introduce him to you. Do you want to come with me? Come. We're going to walk around.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Okay, we're going to go. We are so excited to celebrate Bennett's baptism and to remind him how much he is loved by God. throughout his entire life. We have a certificate of baptism for him, and then also a frame where you can put pictures from today in. So we are excited to welcome you and to welcome Bennett into the family of faith. I will shake your hands, and then you can return to your seats. Here we go. Good job. Thank you. Thank you. Return to your seats. And now the Sunday school children also are dismissed to go to Sunday school. A reminder of parents to pick their children up from the resource room at 11:30. Our scripture for this World Communion Sunday is from 1 Corinthians 12, and this is the story of the one body and the many parts. So hear these words.
For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we are all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving greater honor to the inferior members, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care of one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are members of the body of Christ. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today we are celebrating Worldwide Communion Sunday. This is a celebration that began to recognize that Christians all over the world have different traditions and beliefs, but we are united together by God when we come together at the communion table. To recognize this day today, you are going to hear letters from United Church of Christ missionaries about their experiences serving in diverse communities and cultures around the world. So as you hear these letters, may you hear about how the body of Christ is varied, but how each in their own experiences lives out God's love in the world. And may hearing these letters inspire you to share God's love in your own little corner of the world. I will read one of the letters. Dan Jarris has agreed to read one, and so has Tiffany Warmowski. And in between, we will sing one verse of a hymn. We'll sing each verse of this hymn, and this hymn was written specifically for World Communion Sunday by our director of music, Jeanette Rodriguez. So we will be singing that in between hearing these letters. So the first letter comes from Reverend Scott Cooper, who he writes from South Africa. And he works with the KwaZulu Natal HIV and AIDS Desk of the United Congregational Church of South Africa in Durban, South Africa. A woman named Namvula Shale is HIV positive, he writes, but that doesn't stop her from speaking out. Namvula travels from church to church in South Africa, defying taboos and the stigma of disease in order to provide words of comfort and assurance to those who are drowning in silence. Yesterday, she was at the Highway Hospice. Tomorrow, she will be at King Edward Hospital. Today, she counseled two in the parking lot who were too scared to seek help. What for many would be a harbinger of hopelessness is for Namvula the key that enables her to communicate and to be trusted by all who come to her. Why is she HIV positive? She says, the scripture tells us so that the glory of God might be revealed. Namvula communicates her message to the church, to the government, to schools, and to people. She hosts a talk radio show and writes weekly in the newspaper. She leads the HIV and AIDS desk of the United Congregational Church of Southern Africa, which enables local churches to strengthen their own outreach to their communities. With the help of Global Ministries, Namvula and the HIV and AIDS Desk work together to fight the Goliath of the AIDS pandemic in Africa through such things as grants to purchase life-saving medications, funds for a home-based care project, a new house at the Sebalele Children's Home, and new accommodations for the Sia Ba Tande, literally, which means we are loving them ministry in Nordsburg. The silence about HIV/AIDS needs to be broken, and Namvulu shatters it. In a world in need of hope and direction, Namvulu lives her life the way that God wills the church to be. Now let us sing together.
Letter from East Timor. John Campbell Nelson is a missionary serving the Evangelical Christian Church of Timor. For those of us that are geographically challenged, East Timor is a tiny nation that achieved its independence from Indonesia in 1999. He writes, "Much has changed in Indonesia over the past 25 years, and many people's lives have improved. But the shift from a traditional to a modern way of life is a constant source of social conflict. The hidden constant in the conflict is the role of personal relationships and social status. You are who you know, and who knows you. If you don't know anybody, you are nobody." That realization has been haunting me lately in the form of a dead baby. Her name was Rita Nolinda Ceylon. Her mother died when Rita was a few weeks old. Her father is a farm laborer who has no money. Unable to buy milk, he fed her rice water and sugared tea. Rita starved to death. This sort of thing happens in the hills of Timor all too often. But in Rita's case, it happened less than a mile from our house. The milk she needed was sitting on a shelf in our pantry. The car that could have taken her to the hospital, or her mother before her, was parked in our garage. So why didn't she get the help she needed? Because her father didn't know us. And we didn't know him. When asked why he didn't come to us for help, he said he was malu, translating, that is, a combination of shy, ashamed, and afraid. He knew who we were and where we lived, but he did not feel socially important enough to make requests of the big white people. Rita reminds me that social analyses of the causes of poverty and training on nutrition and public health, while important, are secondary. What is of primary importance is building the kind of community where no one is nobody. That's the kind of community that Jesus worked to create, and it's the kind of community we have yet to become.
Letter from East Timor.
John Campbell Nelson is a missionary serving with the Evangelical Christian Church of Timor. Oh, did I just read? Am I supposed to read Timor or am I supposed to read? Oh, Nepal, sorry. Sorry, excuse me. let's try this again. Letter from Nepal. Andrew and Ellen Collins are former missionaries at the United Mission to Nepal. Nima had been coming to church for weeks, and you'd think she'd always been a Christian. She knew all the songs, raised her hands, and prayed out loud like everyone else, and read the scriptures half a syllable ahead of the others. But when Communion Saturday came along, just before the elements were served, Nima, like all the other non-baptized worshipers, would quietly get up and go outside. In Nepal, communion is offered to all who have publicly declared their faith in Christ and who have been baptized. The pastor makes it very clear that everyone else is welcome to the church service, but must step outside at communion time. I would watch Nima go, and I silently prayed that she would not feel neglected or rejected. I hoped that this seeming lack of inclusiveness on the part of the church would not dampen her interest in Christ. "Are you kidding?" she answered when I finally got up the courage to ask her. "The church is the only place in this country where I, a woman, am truly welcome. Where I, rejected by my family for marrying outside of my caste, am accepted. This is the only group of people who welcome me in despite the fact that I have been treated for mental illness. Even untouchables and lepers are allowed in. Here I find rich and poor, educated and illiterate, sitting together, singing together, sharing a Bible or a hymn book." "Yes, but communion," I started to say. She had already walked off arm in arm with a lady deacon of the church. Several months had passed, and one Sunday I missed church for some reason. Later that day, a Christian friend phoned to say that I should have been there. Nima had stayed for communion. I found out that Nima and her husband had been baptized earlier in the week, and I had missed her first meal at the welcome table. I had known she was attending a class for new believers, and I knew she was growing in her faith, but I did not know that she'd been baptized. When I met Nima and her at her tiny rented room the next day, she beamed at me. "I'm a baptized Christian, and now I stay in church for the whole time. What a great privilege," she exclaimed. Nima was delighted, and I was delighted too. But the thought did cross my mind how some Saturdays, after sitting through 2 hours of church, my legs half asleep from sitting cross-legged on the floor and my brain exhausted from following the sermon in Nepali, I chose to exit with those who had no choice but to leave before communion was served. I so easily passed up what Nima considered a prize. I am constantly amazed at how God has taught me and humbled me over the years I have spent in Nepal through people like Nima. She rekindled in me that day the passion to be present at the table because, like she said, it truly is a great privilege.
I hope that hearing from our missionaries in the United Church of Christ, the ways that people express their faith around the world, has inspired you to express your faith here in this place. At this time, you're invited to think about how you might give back to God this week. You may give by leaving a donation in the box in the back. You may mail or drop off a check to the church. There are also green cards in the pews that you can scan as a way to give of your offerings. We are also so grateful for all the ways that you give of yourselves. For the many ministries that we have here at First Church, we could not give and serve in the way that we do without your help. So thank you for all the ways that you give. In a moment, I will call up John Walsh to come forward as our witnessing steward. Today is the day that our pledge cards are to be received, but no, we will receive them next week and the week after, and whenever you are able to fill them out. Sooner is better, but whenever you're able to get them to us, we will receive them. I do want to, before John comes up, though, I do the prayer time on Communion Sundays during the Communion liturgy, but I do want to lift up the prayer concerns that I did receive this week. As most of you know, our dear friend Tom Scott passed away this past week, and so we keep him and his family and friends and our church family in our prayers, and we will let you know when arrangements have been made for him. We also lost Warren Zentz, Kathy Befundo Zentz's father, this past week as well. So we keep that family and all of his friends in our prayers. And again, we will let you know when arrangements have been made. We also lift up Danny Keel, who received a cancer diagnosis. So we pray for her as she navigates through that. Also, we lift up Lorraine Hoffman, who's having testing done on a lesion that's on her kidney. We also lift up Jennifer Dankers, who is having an MRI on her heart this week. And Marcy Morell asked for prayers for her niece and her baby, who were airlifted to the hospital for a better NICU hospital. We keep all of them in our prayers. I do also have the list. I'll ask my assistant, Tiffany, to bring me the list of homicides. These are those people who died by homicide in the Chicago area this past week. It's been our tradition here at First Church to read these names. And while we don't know them personally, perhaps God knows them and their families. So we think of Charif Mohammed, James Young, Sierra Evans, Luis Flores, Yober Jesus Abaro Sanchez, Thaddeus Scott, Stephanie Lopez Ramirez, age 17, Kevin Bibb, LaShawn Douglas, age 14, Marzell C. Moore, and three unidentified men, two of them age 18. Oh God, hold them in your arms. Know that all these prayer requests go before God, because whether we say our prayer requests out loud or only hold them in our hearts, we know God hears our prayers. I now invite John Walsh to come forward as our witnessing steward.
Good morning. Imagine together. As I think of the stewardship campaign slogan, I think through how I came together with First Church. I grew up in Wheeling, a northwest suburb, the son of a Baptist mom and a Catholic dad, which in the late 60s, you can imagine, was different. But church was important, so I kind of grew up a pan-Protestant. They split the difference. And I have lived around Chicagoland in the suburbs my entire life, except for 4 years where I was at Luther College in Decorah, Iowa, and that's where I met my wife, Kristen. We've been married for more than 30 years. We've lived in Lombard for 24 of those years. I am a high school band director for more than 30 years, and the last 18 of which has been at Glenbard West High School in Glen Ellen. Certainly, this church has been pivotal in my life. We've been going to First Church for about the last 15 years after church shopping, trying old ones, new ones of various denominations. I blame the Coopers for introducing us, and I do use that verb appropriately, blame. But what brought us back to First Church after that introduction? Barbarda. Birthday phone calls, Rob's sermons, Christian education, and youth opportunities. The open and accepting atmosphere that we're always here, that no matter where you are on your journey and the questions about your faith as you grapple with parenting, finances, community, employment, basically life, First Church is the place. It's the place that helped develop connections and community in our local town. It's one thing to live in a town. It's another to be connected to it. First Church really is our foundational connection to Lombard. It's very appropriate that we had a baptism today. My best memory of this space is when we had our children baptized here. Now, my wife and I, Kristen and I, we decided that we didn't want to just baptize them young somewhere. We wanted it to be at the place. So we did it when they were older. Linnea was 5, and my son Aiden was 2. And I told my son, who's now a junior in high school, if he came to church, I wouldn't tell the full story. He didn't come. So this may embarrass him a little. When he was young, he didn't like spaces that were big. So he would always kind of cling a little bit to us. So as a 2-year-old and doing baptism, he was a little clingy that day. So I got to hold him as Pastor Rob baptized Linnea and him on the same day. And at the conclusion of baptizing him, just as Pastor Jill did today, he gave a prayer. And as he raised his hand over Aiden, being a savvy 2-year-old, hey, a hand goes up, a high five must ensue. He smashed his hand into Pastor Rob's to the joy of the congregation. That's First Church. Friday morning golf, men's retreats, women's retreats, where I'm the only dad at home, family retreats, auctions, including the one where we got to celebrate with this community when we moved from our house on the far east side of Lombard to the one we live at now. Trivia nights, youth breakfasts, car washes, chili cook-offs, helping at Sunday school when the kids were younger. Performing various instruments in this space as well as in the chapel. Linnea singing in church. Aiden schlepping drywall in an unair-conditioned construction site in Western Kentucky on a youth trip. These are the experiences of First Church. As Rob would say frequently, remember who you are. And I use that phrase about First Church to remind us all about the many outreach opportunities we have here. I just think of what has come up in the last couple of months. Love Inc., Community Table, NAMI, Crop Walk, later today, 708 Mental Health Boards, our wider church mission in so many ways that it affects not just here in our community, but into the greater world. Through our own church programming, through the Bible, Choosing Peace, our adult faith exploration, the Jack-O-Lantern Jubilee coming up later, and one of my favorite Sundays, Youth Sunday, coming up on October 27th. So as we complete our stewardship campaign, these may be found in the narthex, I am reminded of the Outreach House, which started in 1981 when a number of churches came together to create the Lombard and Villa Park Food Pantry across the street at the Methodist Church. In 1997, First Church started the walk-in ministry, quickly moving into the space right next door to us, 24 West Ash, that has now outgrown that space and in 2022 moved down Main Street. Wonderful that they get to move and expand into a beautiful space, but still reminding us that the need in our community is great and very much needed. So what is the next thing? Imagine together what we can come up with as we chart our course going ahead. Imagine together what some balding, slightly overweight treasurer will say 40 years from now about First Church and what we can do together. Thank you.
Today we are celebrating World Communion Sunday, and in this church, all are welcome to receive communion. This table is not my table or First Church of Lombard's. It is God's table, and it is open to all. Unlike the story from a different tradition, you do not need to be baptized here or anywhere else. You are all welcome to receive at this table. In a few moments, you will be invited. You will be invited to come down the center aisle. You can form two lines. And then today, we do have different kinds of bread on a tray. You may pick one and receive it. Then you will receive a cup. You will drink it. And then there are waste baskets for you to put your cup in. I will tell you, don't spend a lot of time choosing what kind of bread is on the tray. And since they're all cut up, they all look fairly similar. So it's a little bit of a grab bag this morning. I think there's sourdough, there's rye, there's pita, to recognize what is going on around the world and to celebrate in this way. On this World Communion Sunday, we celebrate that we join Christians around the world as we gather at this table. This table extends far beyond this place of worship, and there is, as the choir sang, room for all. So can you see it? Can you envision or imagine the great diversity of God's children celebrating today all around the globe, foreshadowing God's beloved community? At this table, Christ is our host, and we are all guests. We are invited to be renewed in our discipleship as we share in a taste of what is yet to come. So come and taste and see that God is good. Let us pray. God, there is nothing more right than to give you thanks and praise. In a dance of creative spark and divine love, you made all this. You made the dazzling galaxies and the canopies of green leaves and the ocean floors of living coral. You created humanity and called it very good. You gave us intellect and the capacity for growth, but we have misused our gifts. We have turned from you, but you did not turn from us. You sent Jesus to show us the depth of your love, to call us back to faithfulness by the example of his own life, and to welcome us as his siblings and your beloved children. Therefore, we praise you by joining the heavenly chorus and saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." We thank you, O God, for your Son Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. We thank you that he came as a teacher, a healer, a peacemaker. He lived out your love. He encountered and confronted death. And in sharing and showing your love, he held nothing back until his mission was complete. And so we remember, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit on us. Bless this bread we break and the cup we share. In this holy communion, make us one with you and with each other, so that we may become the body of Christ in this world. Remembering our connection to each other, we offer prayers that are on our hearts for the church, for the world, for those we love. We lift up the prayers that were offered earlier in the service today for those grieving, for those facing new diagnosis, for those who are sick of body, mind, or spirit, for those who are hurting. God, we know that you hold them in your loving arms. We ask that through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor belong to you, O God, now and forever. We continue our prayer, saying the prayer together that Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward, and then in a moment when we indicate, you may come forward and receive. If you'd like to remain in your seats, you may, and we will make sure you are served there. This is the feast of God for the people of God. Let us enjoy in love and celebration. People can just take it. That you don't have to hand it to them, they can take it. Yep. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for this meal. We thank you for this meal that connects us not only to you, but to one another around the world. I pray that this meal might strengthen us to share your love as we go into the world this week. We thank you so much for the gift of your Son and the gift of this meal. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I now invite you to stand as you are able as we sing the Church's One Foundation. And now, as you go forth into the world, may you share God's love, and may you know that love yourself. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Go in peace. Please be seated for our postlude.